Good evening, you're watching Estuary News. I'm Hugh Richards. In the headlines tonight, the Icelandic fishermen strike is over, a song and dance at Grimsby Minster, a trip to Iceland for Hull's ex-fishermen, and treasure hunting across North Lincolnshire. And later in tonight's programme, I'll be talking to Nikki Sylvester and Michael Wadicore about saving lives in Lincolnshire. But first, some breaking news. The Chief Constable of Humberside Police has announced that she is to step down. In a statement on the Humberside Police and Crime Commissioner's website, Justine Curran says it's not an easy decision, but that she's proud of the significant impact she's made. Curran has been in the post for almost 4 years and will be replaced in the interim by her deputy, Gary Forsyth. A dispute over pay conditions for Icelandic fishermen has now ended after talks on Friday. The strike lasted for more than 2 months. Less fish has been brought into Grimsby for processing. Grimsby usually gets 75% of its supply from Iceland. Martin Boyers, chief executive of Grimsby Fishstock Enterprises, said he's pleased the strike is over and that fishermen are back to catching. Icelandic fishermen set sail last night, and it's expected that normal service and supplies will be resumed over the next fortnight. The Lincolnshire Police and Crime Commissioner, Mark Jones, has made calls for the force's officers to use spit hoods as protection. This comes after an incident in Louth over the weekend in which police dealt with a violent man on Saturday evening who made threats and started spitting at officers who were trying to arrest him on suspicion of burglary. There are currently no plans for hoods across the county, but Mr. Jones believes officers should have access to the covers, which are placed over an offender's head to act as a barrier to stop them spitting or biting. Three ex-fishermen are set to embark on a journey from Hull to Iceland. The trip is part of Hull Museum's A Common Foe project, and we'll look at the history between Reykjavik and Hull, as well as the history between Iceland and the UK beyond the Cod Wars. A joint exhibition will explore how both Iceland and the UK have helped each other in adversity at sea, as well as confronting each other over fishing rights. The Arctic Corsair and the Icelandic ship Odin's Bells will be temporarily exchanged.
Well, the Arctic Corsair Bell will be aboard the Odin. That's like the Corsair, that's a floating museum run by Reykjavik City Council. The Odin Bell will be in the Hull Maritime Museum from the 15th of July as part of our A Common Foe exhibition.
Too long, the Cod Wars has been seen as a war between two countries. In actual fact, it was merely a dispute over fishing rights and also fishing areas. So it'd be nice to meet people from the other side of the fence, as you, because I was involved in the Cod Wars in the late 60s, early 70s, and it'd be nice to see the other side.
There was confrontation between Icelandic coast guards trying to stop Hull fishermen fishing in their traditional grounds. And underlying all that, there is that respect between the two nations. They respected each other's seamanship. If any ship came to grief, then everyone stopped the confrontation and they tried to help each other out.
This is the last side trawler working out of Hull or Grimsby, or deep sea fish trawler anyway. So it's our heritage. It's something that should be preserved, as the Cuttish Sark or, you know, the SS Great Britain in Bristol. This is as important in our eyes.
Three items of treasure have now been found as part of Scunthorpe's Treasured City project. The idea is the brainchild of artist Luke Jerram, who's created five pieces of art containing a secret code to lead the public to the treasure. The first item, a Viking brooch, was found, was won in the first hour by a woman from Grimsby in Kingsway Gardens in Scunthorpe. The second item, a Roman ram, was found at midnight on Saturday in Brigg Marketplace by a woman from Beverley. And the third item was found last night by a group from Scunthorpe. The group found the fisherwoman at Normanby Hall on the outskirts of the town. Dominic Mason of the Visual Arts Centre says the most difficult items are still to be found.
The most difficult one, I mean, he's worked with a code maker to create them, may take months to be to be solved. And he said it might take longer, it might never be found, and there'll always be the legend of some gold hidden on the streets of Scunthorpe. I think the visitors hope they come away with £2,500 worth of gold, but we really hope that they look at the paintings and they maybe learn a bit about code making, maybe learn a bit about the objects and the history of the area.
Chemicals giant Croda International has invested £27 million in its Hull facility. The investment will double the existing capacity and enable the company to meet growing demand for its products. Hull City Council has been working closely with Croda to support the investment through the Green Port Growth Programme and support for training, skills and research and development. The move will secure existing jobs as well as creating further opportunities during the construction phase. Today marks the 50th anniversary of the Branscombe Estate in Hull. It's said to be the largest council estate in Europe with a population of over 30,000. A special exhibition is now on display at the North Point Shopping Centre with pictures and newspaper articles of the estate over the years. The exhibition is part of the Branscombe 50 celebrations to mark the anniversary of the first house being built on the estate. Grimsby Minster has been making a song and dance with primary school children. The Big Hymn Sing event, the most recent of which took place at Grimsby Minster, brings together primary school children from across northeast Lincolnshire for an afternoon of music. The events are regular and the next one will be taking place in May, and they encourage pupils to take the songs they learn at the Minster or other venues back to their schools. Stephen Maxson, the musical director of the Grimsby Minster, explains further.
I think this is the one we've just done now is the 11th or 12th that we've done, and we started about 3 years ago, and we do them three times a year. We were approached by the local music education hub, who work all the primary schools in the area, and they said a lot of primary schools want to develop assembly singing and hymn singing in particular, and wondered if that was something that a Minster could do. And so we put on these events, and we're getting 300, 400, 500, 600 children a time coming along to them to learn how to sing and then go back into their schools with songs they can teach to the other children there. A big part of what we do as a Minster church is bringing the community in. This isn't our church, this is the church belonging to the town, the whole community. And so today we've got children from Cleethorpes, we've got children from Grimsby schools. In the past we've had children from Caistuff and Grasby. We bring everybody into their church and just enjoy being together, enjoy being a community together and singing together. I think part of it is actually bringing people into this building and bringing children into this building. I love standing by the door just over there as they come in and seeing the wow factor as they come into this beautiful place. But then just hearing them all sing together and then making friendships with new schools and schools they don't know about. And so it's just tremendous. But the thing that really, that I love about Big Hymn Sing is when I hear back from the schools who've taken our materials, I give all the schools a web link with recordings we've made on the Minster organ here and music and words and so on. And when I get a photograph or an email from a school saying, oh, you played the organ in assembly this morning, Stephen, or something, because they've been doing some of our Big Hymn Sing material, that's the impact. And that's great to know that schools in northeast Lincolnshire and beyond are really getting a benefit from this, and it's improving their assemblies and their work in their own buildings.
More churches now. It's time for our weekly reflections, this time from the Reverend Becky Lumley of St Mary's Church in Beverley.
Change is a difficult thing for many people, and how we manage change is not always easy. It might surprise people to know that even vicars go on professional development training courses, and last week I was learning a little bit about change and how we manage it for our own church communities. Of course, change is something we all face, and it's something we all need to be able to deal with. We were thinking about positive change and the changes that can make a difference to our own lives. Some of us probably made New Year's resolutions that we haven't quite managed to fulfill. Some of us have possibly done better. I know for one, I'm still struggling with mine. And the resolution was about bringing change. It was about recognizing things needed to improve or needed to be done differently. I'd quite like to not eat so much sugar. That would be a good thing for my weight. But change is important. Change requires a number of things to happen to make it take place. The first thing that it needs is a vision, a will, a hope, a dream, I hope one day that I can fit into that dress. It also requires dissatisfaction, the idea that, well, I'd like it to be different. It's not quite as I want it to be. And of course, it requires taking the first step as well to make that difference. This is true of small things like my diet, but also, of course, of big things. And when we think about our world, we often see things that we would like to be different, perhaps the way people are spoken about, the way people are treated, the way we view and deal with minorities or people on the edge of society. Jesus was a great believer in creating change, in bringing about the kingdom of God, and he created an extraordinary vision of equality and humanity. And then, of course, he reminded people why it was important, why the world was not as it should be. He created dissatisfaction. And then he took the key steps forwards to make a difference. He showed people how to welcome each other. For us, we probably look around the world and see things that we would like to be different. I hope that we can be brave enough to follow his example and make the first steps to creating a better world.
Join me after the break when Dan brings us a roundup of all the latest sports news, and Nikki Silver and Michael Wadicor will be here telling me about saving lives in Lincolnshire. Welcome back. You're watching Estuary News. Still to come tonight, Dan brings us a roundup of the latest sports news, and I'll be talking to Nikki Silver and Michael Wadicor about saving lives in Lincolnshire. Hundreds of pounds have been raised for Grimsby Hospital by a newlywed couple. Andrew and Rachel Smith asked their guests for money instead of gifts, as they wanted to help local cancer patients. The couple wanted to give something back to local cancer services, as both their families have been affected by the illness. £600 were raised for the hospital, which will be used to purchase specialist cancer equipment. A further £190 will benefit Macmillan Cancer Support. An exhibition celebrating Hull's creative women will launch next week as part of Hull 2017. The Female Gaze is one of 60 projects funded by the 2017 Creative Communities Programme, delivered in partnership with the Big Lottery Fund. The exhibition at the Kingston Art Group Gallery features the work of 10 female artists, including Anna Bean, Julia Roach and Sally Tebb. It's part of a wider series of events at the gallery, which recognises and celebrates the city's creative women. And I'm joined now by Nikki Silver and Michael Wadicor of Lincolnshire Lives, the charity that looks after lives in Lincolnshire, to tell me how people can get involved and help save lives. Thank you both very much for coming in. Tell me, Lincolnshire Lives, very quickly, I know you've been here before, both of you, but just very quickly, Nikki, what is it?
So we're the organisation made up of 700 volunteers that when you dial 999, as well as an ambulance being dispatched to you, one of our volunteers is quite likely to be sent out so as that they can help you in your time of medical emergency.
And the chances are they can get to you much quicker than an ambulance can, because there'll be more of you distributed around the county of Lincolnshire than there are ambulance stations.
Well, with the best will in the world, in the county our size, you can't have an ambulance on every street corner. But we do aim to have people in every sort of town and village and community in Lincolnshire, which does mean that we can get there more quickly.
And Michael, you're looking to recruit more volunteers?
Yes, we're always looking to recruit volunteers, both as community first responders, such as myself, but also fundraisers and people that can help with events.
So you're not necessarily only looking for people with either any medical knowledge or medical interest?
No, we'd like to include as many people as possible.
Okay, excellent. But Nikki.
And of course, you don't have to come to us with medical knowledge. One of the things that we do is take people that perhaps haven't had a whole lot of experience in the medical fields, but we train them up so as that they can respond in their community to whatever level they feel comfortable with.
And well, so there are several levels. There are more experience and the more training you have, the more serious an incident it is, as it were, that you might be expected to deal with.
Or the wider variety of incidents you might go to. So it's most basic. We might train you just to deal with a cardiac arrest that happens in your neighbourhood. And you say, well, that is quite a big, serious event. but it's one where we know that getting somebody there really quickly can make a really big difference. But as you go up the levels, you might perhaps see people with a wider variety of conditions, perhaps poorly children, or perhaps attend sort of trauma events, road traffic collisions and the like. But what we don't say is that you have to do all of it. We can train you to the level that you're comfortable with.
And Michael, you've been doing this for some time.
Yes, I've been doing it heading on for 3 years.
I suppose in the middle of the night in February, when you're going out to find a car crashed into a tree, that's probably not the happiest, but perhaps the most satisfying sort of experience.
It's very rewarding because, you know, in the end of the day, maybe a member of my family that's had a car accident, and I'd want somebody to be there. So the fact that I can go out and make a difference to that person, you know, is really rewarding.
Did you have any medical experience before you started?
No, I'd done sort of a few first aid courses as part of work and this kind of thing, but no real medical training. And I've just progressed up through life, so I now go to really a very broad range of calls.
You've got a bit of kit with you here. Do you want to just put that on the table and we can have a look at what sort of equipment you might be expected to be using? Because if you're going on holidays.
Not the kind of thing you take on holiday normally.
No.
Normally.
Righto. Well, a very quick survey of what we would have here. You've got oxygen, presumably?
We've got oxygen. We've got a defibrillator.
Right.
It's obviously very important if somebody's having a cardiac arrest. I have equipment for dealing with burns, for also cleaning out wounds, this kind of thing. Oxygen masks. We have equipment for taking observations, so we can test the amount of oxygen that's in somebody's blood. We can check the blood pressure. We can check blood glucose. There's a lot of things that we can do prior to the ambulance crew arriving.
Everything you need here to keep somebody alive until they can be taken to an ambulance or taken to hospital?
Very much so, yes.
Okay, all right. What's in the green bag? I'm very curious now.
The green bag is basically more oxygen masks. Okay. There is a thing called a BVM, which again helps people to breathe if they're unable to breathe themselves.
Okay. Nikki, if people want to come and volunteer and help, either in a fundraising capacity or as medical volunteers, as it were, who should they contact? How do they do it?
So a couple of ways you can do it. Have a look at our website, www.lives.org.uk, or give us a call in our headquarters where we can put you in touch with somebody local. So that's 01507 525 999.
Okay. The variety of incidents. I know you've both been out on these jobs, but I mean, you talked about somebody with breathing difficulties at sort of the fairly minor end of the scale. I guess at the other end of the scale, it can be horrible. I mean, the very big dramatic incidents.
Occasionally. I mean, most jobs that we do are very straightforward and it's really looking after people and using the equipment that we've got. Yes, some of the jobs are difficult, particularly if you've been with Lives and you've progressed up the training scale. But again, there's a lot of support there after the call as well.
And how long has Lives been going?
It's our 48th year.
48 years old.
Which is phenomenal.
And it seems very young to me. And how many lives, any estimation of how many lives in Lincolnshire you might have saved or contributed to the salvation of?
Well, what we know is that last year was our busiest year and we saw more than 20,000 patients. And we know that since we started our community first responder scheme in 2000, we've seen more than 200,000 patients. And we know that every year there are several hundred people that we can point to and say, you know what, there's a really good chance that person wouldn't have been there if it wasn't for somebody in Lives or somebody like Michael.
So 700 of you saved, or at least attended to and helped, 20,000 people, or 20,000 incidents in Lincolnshire.
20,000 incidents last year. January was our busiest month ever. We did more than 2,000 just in January of this year. So we're just getting busier and busier, which is why, you know, the more the merrier as far as we're concerned. We're really keen for people to join and to help. And one thing that I can promise people is that we will put the investment into making sure that they've got the skills to help people in their community, just like Michael and, you know, 700 other people do.
Any particular areas in the county where you're particularly short of people?
I would say right across the board we could do with more. Always sort of down the coastal areas are difficult for us. And some of the inland towns, Market Raisin, Caister and the like, we could always do with some more people. But, you know, there's room for people right across the board. My aspiration is that we have somebody on call right across the whole of Lincolnshire, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And we need more people to be able to do that.
Nikki, thank you. Michael, thank you very much. Be careful out there. And thank you very much for all that good work. Here's Dan with all the sports news.
We'll start with a roundup of the weekend's football results. 10-man Scunthorpe United held off the advances of league leader Sheffield United to pick up a point at Bramall Lane in a top-of-the-table clash. The Iron took the lead early in the second half through Paddy Madden before ex-Iron striker Billy Sharp equalised just 2 minutes later. Harry Toffolo was then sent off for United, but they held out for over half an hour as the game finished one apiece. Scunthorpe remain 5 points behind the leaders, but are now just 2 points clear of third place. Grimsby Town picked up their first win in five. They beat promotion-chasing Mansfield Town 3-0 at Bluntall Park. Loney Callum Dyson scored a double, while Chris Clements opened the scoring for the hosts in a game in which the visiting manager Steve Evans was sent to the stands. Meanwhile, the club have announced plans for a fans forum today. That will take place at McMenemy's Bar on Thursday the 9th of March. Director John Fenty will be there to answer your questions along with the manager. It'll be getting underway from 7 o'clock. A Curtis Bateson free kick wasn't enough to help North Ferriby United to a win at home to Dover. The Villagers had taken the lead at the Eon Visual Media Stadium, but they eventually fell to a 2-1 defeat. They host FA Cup quarter-finalists Lincoln City tomorrow night. And finally on football for now, Cleethorpes Town are just 2 games from a Wembley final. They've been drawn to face Midland League side Bromsgrove Sporting and home and away for a place in the FA Vars final. That's after the Owls won 5-2 at Southall on Saturday. And Hull Kingston Rovers have kept up their 100% start to life in the Championship. They won 28-18 at the Rochdale Hornets. Thomas Minns went over the whitewash twice in the win, which moves the Robins to top spot, level on points with Featherstone. Meanwhile, the Robins reserve side are in action tonight against their black and white counterparts. Kickoff is at 7:30 at KCOM Craven Park. And finally, ice hockey. The Hull Pirates lost the first leg of the Bradfield Brewery Cup 4-2 to the Sheffield Steel Dogs yesterday. The second leg is in a couple of weeks' time at the Sheffield Arena. That's on Friday, the 3rd of March. And that's all for the sport.
Thanks very much, Dan. That's it for tonight. If you want to comment on anything we've talked about this evening or get in touch with us, a story, the details are below me, Facebook or Twitter, email news at estuary.tv or phone Grimsby 01472 31553. Until tomorrow, good evening.
Are you looking for a new or used car? Whatever the weather, Trenton have you covered. Estuary TV Weather, sponsored by Trenton Motors. Are you looking for a new or used car? Whatever the weather, Trenton have you covered. Estuary TV Weather, sponsored by Trenton Motors.
Good evening, you're watching Estuary News, I'm Hugh Riches. In the headlines tonight, the next phase of Grimsby's new stadium, Hull women in London to fight for fairer pension rights, and the future of a seaside library. And later in tonight's programme, I'll be talking to Dick Heath about his Lincolnshire poetry. The Humberside Police and Crime Commissioner Keith Hunter has announced that the search is on for a new Chief Constable. Justine Curran announced yesterday that she is to retire as Chief Constable of Humberside Police after serving 4 years in office, saying the time is right for the next chapter. Mr. Hunter said Humberside Police stands a better chance of moving forward with some new leadership and opportunity for improvement. He now wants to appoint a new Chief Constable who can lead the force on the next stage of its development. Ms. Curran will be replaced in the interim by her deputy, Gary Forsyth. North East Lincolnshire Council Cabinet members will meet next week to discuss the next phase of a new stadium in Grimsby. The meeting will consider recommendations to grant Grimsby Town and its developers Extreme permission to purchase the council's land on Peaks Parkway for the multi-million pound development. The recommendations form part of a report which states the development of a community stadium in the borough will contribute to both a stronger economy and stronger communities. The stadium will include the creation of new facilities for community use, along with construction, employment and training opportunities. That meeting is on the 28th of February. Dozens of Hull women have been marching in Westminster today in a fight for fairer pension rights. The Hull Women Against State Pension Inequality Group, known as WASPI, represent 10,000 Hull women who've been affected by pension changes. Women born in the 1950s will now have to work longer into their 60s before they're eligible for their pensions, meaning on average a woman will lose about £40,000 as a result of the changes.
The right thing to be done is to make transitional, fair transitional payments to these women that have lost countless thousands of money. 10,000 women are affected in this city, 2.65 million women nationally. I wear my suffrage colours with pride, as I do my WASPI banner. I wear them both. These women, the suffrage women, fought for the right to vote. These women are fighting for the right to a pension.
Police are appealing for witnesses after a robbery in Grimsby. The incident happened on Thursday night at around 9:30 when a 54-year-old man was walking alone down Ropery Street and he was approached by two men. The men assaulted the victim before taking his wallet and phone and leaving the area, heading in the direction of Convermore Road. The victim suffered minor injuries in the incident. Speculation is rife over the future of Cleethorpes Library. North East Lincolnshire Council has revealed that one possible way of saving money will be to close the library. The council has since said that plans for closure are not set in stone. Campaigners say they want to preserve a key service in Cleethorpes. Fred McNamara brings us the story.
A community backbone, exhibition centre and of course a literary hub, Cleethorpes Library is a treasured landmark of the town. But it might also be under the threat of closure. The possible closure of the library is one option North East Lincolnshire Council are considering to save money. However, campaigners are keen to keep the library alive and are doing so in their thousands.
Well, we've reacted as residents. I'm just a local resident and there's lots of other people involved in this campaign. There's Lynn Sales from DN35, there's Vicky Mutton, there's Peter. And we've reacted, we've contacted the media, we've campaigned, we got a petition going. We didn't even push it that hard and we got 3,000 signatures. And bearing in mind the population of Cleethorpes, that is a large amount of signatures. So there's massive public feeling that this building needs to stay. And I think you only have to look at it today to see how busy it is, how well used it is, and what a function it serves. I am a school teacher, and this is my half term. And I found out in the last 2 weeks that we've got enough jobs in the Humber region for everyone, which is amazing. But we need literate, numerate people with good social skills. And, you know, I walk into the library here and I see young kids who are talking, interacting, reading, doing the very things that you would want as a teacher and also want as an employer. So if we shut that, I'm really worried that we're not going to take advantage of the great opportunities coming our way economically. Kids are not going to have the skills and they're going to miss out, and the whole region, North East Lincs, is going to miss out.
Beyond the economic and community benefits, there's also plenty of intimate history attached to this library.
Well, I live with my grandmother. I've always lived with her. She brought me up. My mum was there too. I never had my father with us. And I came from Nottingham and we lived on the seafront in a big house. My grandmother signed me up for the library when I probably was only about 5 or 6, and this was the old library on Isaac's Hill. And I was in the library, I was an avid reader, all the five books, Enid Blyton and Mallory Towers and all the books that girls loved. And I've never lost my love of books. And I know internets have come on and you've got all sorts of technology that I can't even follow now. But they're still not the same as browsing in a lovely old bookshop or coming to a library. And I think if we lost this, the library, it would be such a terrible shame for the young people who do enjoy a book. It's not the same. You've got more choice. You haven't got choice if you just have a little thing to scroll down on, as you've got when you've got hundreds and hundreds of books. I'm in today and I wanted to look at a book on a man because I'd like to go on holiday. And I don't know anything about a man and I'm not too good on the internet. So I've got a book out, and this evening when I've got 5 minutes, I'll be able to sit with my feet up and a cup of tea and read this book. And thanks to the library, I haven't got to buy it and I can return it if it doesn't suit me.
People without any money can just come here, because if they don't have any money for books, then here it's free to buy to get the books.
Yeah, for me, libraries are essential services. They're like a hospital. They are absolutely crucial, and you only have to talk to different people to see the different ways in which they're used. For some people, this fulfills a fantastic social function. For other people, it's a way in which they advance their careers. For other people, it's a social thing, and it's the fact that it's free that's so important.
With concerns that the library's closure could result in damage to the community, the fight to keep Cleethorpes Library open battles onward. Fred McNamara, Estuary News.
A public safety day will be held tomorrow on Hull's Long Hill estate. Staff from Humberside Police, Humberside Fire and Rescue Service, the Fire Brigade, and Hull City Council will be visiting more than 200 homes on the estate to raise awareness of arson and antisocial behaviour. The joint effort will involve residents being visited by teams of community safety partners to offer fire safety and crime prevention advice, installing smoke alarms and identifying residents who have been victims of repeated arson or crime. The event will be taking place between 10 a.m. and 3 p.m. near to the East Mount Centre. A new exhibition of the work of people with dementia goes on display in Hull tomorrow. As part of Hull 2017, the exhibition called Hull, We Made It, We Did, is part of the Butterfly Effect and will take visitors on a journey seen through the eyes of people with dementia and those who support them. It'll use music, photography, sculpture and performance art to explore the lives of people living with a condition. The exhibition is at Cardoma 94 from 12 p.m. until 4 p.m. tomorrow afternoon. After 3 months of extensive repairs, St John's Church has now reopened to the public. The church, which forms part of the 2021 Visual Arts Centre in Scunthorpe, had to remain closed owing to a piece of masonry falling from the roof. As a result, the rest of the church was closed off to the public to allow repair work to be carried out, but it's now open just in time for Luke Jerram's Treasured City exhibition.
Unfortunately, we've been closed since the beginning of December because there was a small piece of masonry fell off the building. We're a Grade 2 star listed building in the former church of St John's, and I've got the piece that fell off here. As you can see, it's quite a small piece, and luckily it's only a decorative piece, but as a precaution, obviously, we don't want anything falling on anyone, so the outside of the building was cordoned off. And the upshot of that was it was time to check the rest of the building as well, so we had a very in-depth survey take place with a specialist conservation company. That's kind of taken 3 months to complete, but here we are now, and we're luckily able to reopen. I mean, it is an old Victorian building, and obviously wear and tear happens, and they're doing a bit more research into the stonework, hence why we're keeping the barriers on the outside for the time being. There was a worry that if a big bit was loose, it could possibly fall through the roof, and that's why the precautionary measure was taken to close the inside of the building as well, unfortunately. We've got a scheme of all works that needs to be done to get the building back to where it needs to be as well, and obviously we're working with the conservation officer on that and also specialist teams. So the good news is that there's no imminent danger of anything terrible happening, but there will be works done. We did have a plan A, B and C should the work take a bit longer, and so on Saturday we've got a very exciting exhibition by international artist Luke Jerram, who's hidden 5 pieces of gold. Each piece is worth at least £2,500. And the idea is that people can come into the gallery and have a look at a series of 5 paintings which will give clues to where the gold is hidden in the area. And the paintings range in difficulty from one that allegedly a child could solve to one that might never even be found. So that's all very exciting. And also we've got a Lego exhibition called Brick City coming up as well. So we're really, really pleased to be back in business. I just think it's, you know, people always say to us, oh, I wish there was something like this in my town. And if you see, it's used by people from all walks of life, people who have all different tastes in art, and we do like hands-on activities. It's not just for children, it's for adults. And, you know, this is a beautiful, iconic building in the town, and it's good to see it put back to use for the service of the community.
Join me after the break. Dan will be bringing us a roundup of the latest sports news, and Dick Heath will be here telling me more about poetry inspired by Lincolnshire. Welcome back. You're watching Estuary News. Still to come tonight, Dan brings us a roundup of all the latest sporting action, and I'll be talking to Dick Heath about poetry in Lincolnshire. A sound and vision project will bring together young people in Hull. Created in community-based workshops, the movable, vibrant exhibition spaces will be used to offer interactive opportunities to bring a wider audience and intergenerational connections together at public events throughout Hull 2017. The Tents, Dens and Teepees workshop will be taking place tomorrow at the Astra Youth Centre on Barnstable Road between 12 p.m. and 5:30 p.m. Sound and Vision is one of 60 projects to receive funding through the Hull 2017 Creative Communities Programme, which aims to raise awareness of youth culture and youth arts to a wider audience. Now, I'm joined by Dick Heath, who's here to talk about his new collection of poetry based on his home and beloved county of Lincolnshire. Dick, welcome. Thank you very much for coming on.
Thank you.
Before we start, I think we'd better start with one of the poems, if I may. Yes. If you'd be kind enough to read it out.
Crow Joe, it's called. Poor old Joe, standing in the 30-acre, looks as if he's off to meet his maker. He's all downtrod and broken down. It looks as though he's at the end. In 30 acres, there's no friend. But still, his job he must complete to scare the crows from off the wheat.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. I noticed a bit of, it was a little Lincolnshire dialect in there.
Yes.
30 acres.
Yes. Well, some people have trouble with that, but I mean, the dialect is probably dying out.
What does 30 acres mean?
30.
30 acres.
30
okay,
acres.
I should probably have spotted that.
Yes, because we're all hectares now, so.
Oh, let's. Acres are much more poetic. Let's stay with that. Now, 30 Lincolnshire poems. It's a very concisely and accurately named volume, and they're all poems inspired by the county.
Yes.
You're a Lincolnshire man born and bred.
Oh, yes, yes.
Spent the last 8 decades in the county.
Yes.
What is it about Lincolnshire that inspired poetry?
I don't really know. It's mainly comes from, as I'm going around, I see something and that brings on the poetry, on the muse. I can't understand it, really.
It really inspires you, literally. And, it comes from somewhere.
And a lot of it is looking back at my youth sort of thing and the things that went on 80-odd years ago.
These are not sort of horrible, deep, dark poems about the long, dark night of the soul. This is great fun, isn't it,
book? Yes, yes. Yes, I can't go into that sort of genre. I prefer to smile and keep it happy all the time.
I'm just reading through the book. There's a lot of giggles in it. It's quite clever stuff and very, very humorous stuff as well.
I hope so, yeah.
How long have you been writing poetry?
Well, I started writing a novel originally. I think it was after I retired. I was ill for a while and then I wasn't as agile as I used to be. And so I started making my mind more agile. I started writing a novel for a start and then went on to poetry. and it seemed to come naturally, sort of thing, you know.
It's not, some poets would say that writing prose is very dull because you need that discipline of just getting a bit of a rhythm and a bit of rhyme in
there. It makes a difference, I suppose. But I do have to, I mean, I write them down and then I'll go back to them and probably alter them several times, you know, before I'm satisfied with the final.
Well, you've very graciously given your wife an acknowledgement in the front page here. I think
yes.
You're not quite using a quill pen and parchment, are you? But
oh,
you're
no.
not far off.
No, no, it's the biro.
It's the biro, is it?
Yeah.
And then poor old Mrs. Heath has to type it up for you.
Yes, yeah. She's the one with the computer skills, and I'm too old for that, I think, you know. Could never get in touch with
it. Not quite too old for a typewriter, if I may say so.
No, it could be one way around, but then the computer is a typewriter, really, isn't it?
I guess it is. Pen and ink is much more human and much more warm-blooded, I suppose, isn't it?
Well, that's sort of the only way I can produce them. I couldn't look at the keyboard and produce anything.
We'll have a word afterwards. I'll show you how to do it. This is one, not the only thing, but where can people get their hands on 30 Lincolnshire Poems?
Well, there's several places. It's on sale in the Buttercross at Brigg, and a garden centre at Sunnyside Garden Centre at Tealby. It's also on sale in Lincoln at the Jews Court, and
I think there's somewhere
k.com. kbooks.com, yes, that's okay. Another one of the places.
Highly recommended, published by Toucan, price £6.50, and an absolute bargain. Before you go, I can't let you go without telling me at least a little bit of something about a future project you're thinking about, the Lincolnshire Beast.
Yes, well, I have written a ballad about the Lincolnshire Beast. This, I think, it's not a beast that has ever been heard of before, all in my mind, really, sort of thing. But it's mainly that Lincolnshire was formed by a hideous beast.
I think that's maybe a little unfair on Lincolnshire there.
I don't know. It's only the wolds and...
But this is a beast that has its roots in the Nordic and the Viking, and it came down from the north. Don't give away the ending, but briefly tell me the story.
Well, roughly, it came down, it split the coast of Norway into fjords with its claws, and then it jumped across into Scotland, where all the brave Scotsmen ran without their kilts.
Explains a lot.
And then it went into Northumberland and dragged up Lundy Island, where they pray even now for its demise. And then it got into Yorkshire, and in Yorkshire they tried to find somebody to kill it. And they found this serf and put him on a horse and sent him off with a lance and some armour. And the dragon just swatted him into the air with its tail. And when he came down, it was his demise, sort of thing. His lance did actually kill the dragon. And it reared up on the coast of Yorkshire, and supposedly Lincolnshire wasn't there at that time. It was just a low swamp sort of thing.
Right.
And he slides into Lincolnshire in his death throes, on his yellow belly, of course.
Of course, a yellow-bellied Lincolnshire dragon, yes.
And then he dies in Lincolnshire, and his remains form the Lincolnshire Wolds, and his tail breaks off and gouges the Humber, and the sea runs in the Humber Trench, and it falls in Yorkshire and makes the Wolds in Yorkshire.
Dick, that sounds like the most wonderful new mythology. Absolutely fantastic. 30 Lincolnshire Poems available from various places. Dick, thanks so much for coming in.
Thank you.
Here's Dan with all the sports news.
North Ferriby United host FA Cup giant killers Lincoln City tonight in the National League. Tonight's visitors are having a dream season, having knocked Premier League Burnley out of the cup on Saturday. The Villagers are in need of a win to hold themselves off the foot of the table, while Lincoln currently sit top. The game kicks off at Ferriby's Eon Visual Media Stadium tonight at 7:45. Hull City haven't received a formal offer for striker Abel Hernandez. That's according to reports today. The Uruguayan was once City's record signing and is reportedly attracting the interest of Chinese Super League club Beijing Guoan. It's thought any deal would be worth around £15 million. Despite the transfer window in Europe's major leagues closing at the end of January, the window in China remains open until next Tuesday. Grimsby Town's reserves have been in action this afternoon. They've been hosting Mansfield Town at Blundell Park, with an entire starting 11 made up of senior pros. Club captain Craig Disley started, as well as Brandon Comley, Josh Gowling and Akwasi Asante. There was a bit of rugby action last night. Hull Kingston Rovers' under-23s overcame their Hull FC counterparts by 42 points to 18 at KCOM Craven Park. Over 1,000 fans saw Rovers' Ben Kakane make his return to action in a side which also included coach David Hodgson. Nick Rawsthorne and young prospect Massey Matonga lined up for the Black and Whites. And finally, rugby union. Hullensians lost 51 points to 5 at home to West Leeds in Yorkshire 1 at the weekend. Pete Osborne scored the only try of the game. They're now 10th after sustaining their 11th loss in 20 outings.
Thank you, Dan. That's all for tonight. If you'd like to get in touch, comment, or with a story, then please look at Estuary TV on Facebook or on the Twitter. Email us on news@estuary.tv or phone Grimsby 01472 31553. Write to us, Estuary TV, Nuns Corner, Grimsby, DN345BQ. Until tomorrow, good evening.
Are you looking for a new or used car? Whatever the weather, Trenton have you covered. Estuary TV Weather, sponsored by Trenton Motors. Are you looking for a new or used car? Whatever the weather, Trenton have you covered. Estuary TV Weather, sponsored by Trenton Motors.
Good evening, you're watching Estuary News. I'm Hugh Richards. In the headlines tonight, the future of a seaside library, the city of Hull is a sea of blue, and baby footprints help bring art to life as part of the city of culture. And later in tonight's programme, I'll be working 9 to 5 with Jackie Bacon and Joe Hagman talking about Dolly Parton. And before that, Mick Enright and Ewan Gloin tell me about how Cleethorpes is going to be inked. An 18-month-old child has been seriously injured in a collision in Grimsby. It happened yesterday afternoon on St Nicholas Avenue near a Chinese takeaway. It involved a silver-coloured Mercedes car. The child was taken to Sheffield Children's Hospital and is currently receiving treatment. The family is receiving support following the incident. Officers are questioning the driver of the vehicle. Hull has again been awash with blue bodies today. The Ferens Art Gallery has announced today that the Sea of Hull, produced by New York-based artist Spencer Tunick, will be exhibited in the venue from April the 22nd. It'll all be part of the Skin exhibition, part of Hull as the UK City of Culture. pieces by Lucien Freud and Edward Manet will both be part of the work. Kirsten Simister is the curator of the gallery.
The whole idea was to provide an exhibition that would really wow audiences and really amaze them. And so we really went out thinking, what can we do that will be very bold and powerful and will really appeal to people and really amaze and inspire them. So it's definitely an exhibition that's incredibly ambitious, and the artists are incredibly important international names.
Over 3,000 people from Hull and much further afield came together last summer to pose naked for Spencer Tunick's artwork, and we caught up with a few of them this morning to see how well hung they are in the Ferns.
Like, now we've done it, it's a case of, wow, yeah, why not?
And looking forward to it, because, not too worried, because we ended up right at the front on one of the pictures, so it was on the front of the Guardian, so I've had my face in the front page of the Guardian, so I'll be all right.
You can't get any worse.
It's not going to get any worse.
The reason that I did it is because I've got a little boy and he's sort of seven, and I thought if I'm going to be in the Ferns Art Gallery in Hull, it made me really proud to be able to take him in there and say that when we did that installation, she was part of that. So that's why I did it, because I thought in future generations coming in and thinking I've got a picture in Ferns Art Gallery, and that means the absolute world to me. I go in there all the time. So to be part of the exhibition just means everything. It's so wonderful.
I'm a little bit nervous, because being part of the group photo is going to be amazing. But, you know, a bit, little bit nervous, I'm really visible, but hey-ho, I'll be in blue, so.
The MP for Cleethorpes, Martin Vickers, has said there's been a U-turn on the future of the resort's library. North East Lincolnshire Council indicated last month that the library could be closed as a cost-saving drive, but the closure has now been removed from council papers ahead of a meeting tomorrow night. A petition of more than 3,000 signatures was passed to Mr. Vickers and the Mayor of North East Lincolnshire earlier this month, lobbying the council to rethink its decision. Police are investigating a burglary at an elderly woman's property in Grimsby. A suspect broke into an address in the Ridgeway on Friday morning and stole cash from the 82-year-old's bedroom. The woman was not present at the time of the break-in, but has been left shaken by the incident. Police are keen to speak to a man who was seen in the area at the time, who was carrying a ladder and a sweeping brush. Taxis across East Yorkshire are the first in the Humber region to adopt a distinctive white and green colour scheme to improve public safety. The pilot scheme, running until May, will see white taxis adorned with green markings and displaying a Yorkshire Rose symbol, making them easily identifiable. The project, implemented by East Yorkshire Council, which aims to improve identification and enhance security and safety. All taxis will be in the colours by December 2020. Finishing touches are being made to the initial part of one of Hull's first City of Culture projects. Born into a City of Culture, launched on New Year's Day, and will see a large work of art installed in Hull Royal Infirmary gradually over the year. Throughout 2017, every baby born in the city will have their footprint taken to adorn the mother and children's unit at the hospital. Local firm Jenko is putting the final touches to the first portion today. Luke Adams has been along to find out more.
With the first of 12 panels set to go up next week, Colin Wilson from The Designers explains all.
The hospital have taken a footprint of every baby that's been born so far in January. So we've got 381 babies' feet. Those are scanned and we've put them onto a piece of specially designed artwork. Andrew, our designer, actually is an ex-Hull College student, is now fully employed at Jenko, and he did the design, which is based on 12 panels which are going to be put up into the foyer of the hospital, the Women and Children's Hospital. And we're at the moment, Andrew is just currently putting that first panel piece of artwork together.
And here are a few of the young faces that, in years to come, will be able to look back and say they were part of it, even if they're not too clued up on it at this moment. Amy and Jonathan Leafley have welcomed baby Harriet into the world, and they're delighted to be part of the City of Culture celebrations.
Yeah, it's really special, actually, to be included. And when I found out that she was going to be born into the year, it felt really good.
And how do you feel about having her footprint as a piece of artwork, which will obviously be...
It's very good. I think it's a very special and very nice thing for to happen during this year, especially with everything that's going on in Hull. Brilliant.
Isabella has also had her footprint taken, and her mum Jennifer says it'll be a nice memento to look back on in years to come.
How does it feel to have your baby born as part of this monumental year for the City of Culture?
Yeah, it's really special. It'll be something that she can look back onto when she was a little bit older, and it's just nice to be part of kind of the history of Hull in this special year. But yes, really, really special.
Sally Ward is a community and midwifery sister at the hospital and is the brains behind the project.
When I found out that Hull was going to be a City of Culture for 2017, I thought it'd be really exciting to do a project that was right at the very beginning of life. So babies that were born into a City of Culture, that's what we called it, because we thought it'd be brilliant to do something with the footprints. And then we thought about running them down the corridors in the hospital. Then we thought, no, we'll create a piece of art that will be able to be sustained so that they'll be able to come back later and visit it. And we thought it'd be a really good idea to do that. And it's going to be trees, 12 trees throughout the year, and they're all going to be in colour going through the season. So we'll start with winter and snow, going through the blossom in summer, right through to the autumn leaves. And every month a panel will be put up into the entrance hall, so it will grow month by month throughout the year.
And this is where the artwork is going to be installed. Behind me there will be four panels which will showcase all the baby's footprints that will be born throughout Hull 2017 here at the Women and Children's Hospital at the Hull Royal Infirmary.
Now, Cleethorpes will be awash with ink later this year with the resort's first ever tattoo convention. I'm joined now by Mick Enright and Ewan Gloyne to tell me more. Gentlemen, welcome.
Thank you.
Ewan, I notice that you are a living embodiment of the art form.
Yes, definitely. It's something I'm very passionate about.
First of all, let's get the details. Mick, when is the festival and where will it be?
16th and 17th of September at the Beachcomber. Originally, we were scheduled to go in April, but we've had such a massive response that we've got to reassess the whole situation now. We get some more extra areas from Beachcomber which can put various things in, because there's all sorts of people want to be body out, want to be there. There's going to be custom cars, motorbikes, you name it. People just seem to want to come and be there, so we've said, hang on, let's step back here a minute. We need to make sure we do this properly. Someone suggested we do two, but it's not going to happen, we'll do one.
Tattoo is definitely a work of art, and you're and just looking at your arms, and I haven't seen the rest. It is a work of sort of design and draftsmanship and calligraphy and just whatever the technique is of doing that. But how do you display it? Because it's work of art on human beings. You can't hang them up on a wall.
Well, that's exactly why we wanted to do the convention. At the end of the day, tattoos, most people have got them nowadays. A lot of people have got them. They're very, very popular. So we wanted to do something where the artists themselves can actually put their work on display. And the best way to do that is to do a tattoo convention. As Mick said, when we first had the concept of doing it, we wanted to do it mainly just for the local artists, because believe it or not, there is a vast number just in Grimsby and Cleethorpes and the surrounding areas. But we've had that much interest, there's been national interest in it now. And there's many across the UK, many different conventions. But for some reason, they tend to like a seaside venue. So that's why ours seems to be going great guns at the moment.
Yeah, it seems fair to me. Nothing wrong with that. Mick, you're an old fisherman. You must be an illustrated man. You must be covered in that.
Never had a tattoo in my life. Never had a tattoo in my life. No, never. I mean, I'm as I am. Fisherman, you're right, in the old days, back in the 60s, everybody, fishermen have a tattoo, but I didn't want that, you know, that pain. It may be pleasure or pain. Ewan says it's pleasure.
Well,
but
I was I'm going to ask, first of all, I mean, very quickly, does it hurt?
It doesn't hurt. It's uncomfortable, but it doesn't hurt.
Okay, and it's worth it for the product that you get afterwards.
Definitely.
Secondly, and this is, I'm sorry for a boring question you must often be asked, but it's very permanent. How do you decide, how do you make that decision of what you're going to commit to?
A lot of thought does go into it. I'll be honest, it does annoy me when I've been sat in tattoo studios and I've seen somebody come in, just look at something for 5 minutes on a wall and say, that's what I want. You have to put a lot of thought into it, because there are people that do regret having them. But I think once you've decided what you want and it's something that you definitely want, then just get it done.
Ewan, Mick, thank you both very much, and I hope you have an absolutely splendid festival.
Thank you very much.
I might be just getting a little one somewhere.
good.
Join me after the break when Dan brings us a roundup of all the latest sports news, and I'll be talking about Dolly Parton with Jackie Bacon and Joe Hagman. Welcome back. You're watching SG News. Still to come tonight, Dan brings us a roundup of the latest sports action, and I'll be working 9 to 5 with Jackie Bacon and Joe Hagman. More than 1,000 anglers are set to return to the East Yorkshire coast next week. As part of the European Beach Championships, anglers from over 12 countries are expected in Hornsea to reel in a share of £35,000 in prize money. It's the world's largest three-day beach angling festival and has been running for 24 years. This year's event will be held from the 24th of February to the 26th. Barton's shopfronts are to receive a new lease of life. The traditional shopfront grant scheme allows shops in the conservation area of North Lincolnshire to get repair and installation works for new traditional styled shop fronts. Councillor Rob Waltham of North Lincolnshire Council says that the scheme is all about putting faith in the town.
The plan is that shop owners will be able to apply for a grant up to £7,500 if they're in the conservation area to make improvements to front of their shop. So typically that could be a new shop front, it might be some structural work that needs to be done to the front of their building, but it will be, you know, a massive investment in Barton from the council's perspective in terms of supporting shops in the town, but also continually supporting the regeneration of Barton itself. I mean, we first of all think that town centre is an important part of our local economy. We know that lots of people work in town centres and we want to do our best to support them. Here in Barton we have free car parking in council owned car parks, and also obviously this is an element of a fund that we've had. We've just reinstated and investing in the new bus shelter behind us. This is just part of a continual regeneration in our area. Barton deserves this extra investment. It's part of we've got here quite a special conservation area, and we want to make sure that we've got a typical design that fits the fronts of each of these shops. And by doing that, you know, and by investing some money to make sure that that theme follows through, we'll keep a traditional shop front, but at the same time make sure that these shops are viable for many years to come.
Hull City Council has announced plans to resurface parts of West Hull. If the plans are given the go-ahead, they would see roads on Newland Avenue and Cottingham Road redeveloped as part of a £125,000 scheme. The existing roads are beginning to crumble, with further deterioration if the work isn't carried out. The council is now accepting bids to carry out the works. Now, I'm joined in the studio by Jackie Bacon and Joe Hagman, who are here to tread the boards with a musical version of 9 to 5. Ladies, welcome. Thank you both very much for coming in. Let's just identify your roles. Jackie, you're the director.
I am, yes.
And Joe, you're playing Violet.
That's right. Yeah.
And we will be familiar with 9 to 5 as I think it's a 1980 film.
That's right.
Starring
Dolly Parton.
The unforgettable Dolly Parton, though you're in a role played in the film by
Lily Tomlin.
She was a sort of dry, witty one,
yes,
wasn't she?
She was.
In the piece.
She's the older one in the office.
And there were three of them. The third one in the film was played by
Jane Fonda.
They're all familiar names, aren't they?
They are.
Okay.
Yes.
You better just, without spoiling anything, you better just tell us what happens.
Well, the story centres around the three women in the office, Violet in particular, who is looking for promotion, but way back in the 70s, which is when the film is actually set, women didn't get promotion. And the boss, Mr. Hart, is a very egotistical, sexist, bigot of a man, as lots of men were in those days. And he just likes to keep the women down, so they decide that they'll get their own back on him, kidnap him, tie him up, and take over the office.
It's really fantastic. It's a Jacobean revenge drama, isn't it?
It basically definitely is, yeah.
Except with fantastic music.
It is, yeah.
So tell us, what sort of music can we expect?
Oh, all sorts. So it's a complete mixture. It's written, the music and lyrics are by Dolly Parton. And it's obviously got the classical 9 to 5 number, which I'm sure most people will know and recognise, but a huge number of this, about
12 or 13 numbers in it, very varied from ballads to sort of upbeat numbers. So it's great, fantastic music. There's a society, we're the Scunthorpe Musical Theatre Society, and the whole company are really enjoying the music.
So there are big choir numbers as well, and there's
big chorus numbers, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah.
35 people in all, with ages ranging from 16 to 80.
Really?
He's the oldest person in it, he's 80.
Okay. I'm not going to be tactless enough to ask about the physique of the person playing Dolly Parton, but she became famous in that film, didn't she? That was what really put her...
She did. That was the film was what set Dolly Parton off on the road to fame, really. It was centred around her, and the character of Dora Lee is based on Dolly Parton. And our Sophie, our Dora Lee, is fabulous. Mm. She's a bubbly, blonde, cheeky, curvy, exactly as she should
be.
Well,
that answers the question I didn't ask, I suppose, doesn't it? one thinks of Dolly Parton. But you say that that's the lead, the Dolly Parton role, but it's really not, it wasn't an egotistical film, and it's not an egotistical production for Parton, because it's quite an ensemble piece, isn't it?
Absolutely. So there's the three of us, the three girls, but we have, you know, without the chorus and the other members, it wouldn't work. So although we've got a big part, it's a great, fantastic piece to be in.
Dolly's not actually the lead. Violet, if you like, is the largest of the parts, but Dolly Parton,
she's got all the
centres about
she?
Her. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. It's fabulous. There's a really good spread of material for everybody that's involved in the show.
Now, you said it's the baddie, is this horrible, misogynistic, sexist boss who's exploiting the women working for him. And you said, in those days, very carefully. Is it not? Let's hope. You can tell me if I'm right or wrong, but is that all a bit old-fashioned and anachronistic nowadays?
You'd hope so.
I would hope so. Yes, I think so. But I do think it still goes on sometimes. But not the way it was then. I mean, some of the lines in the show, he's really very, very nasty and very spiteful, and women would have his guts for garters these days if he spoke to them the way he speaks to the ladies in the show.
It's hot. I'm just watching the film, even, you know, 30 years later. It's difficult to watch.
It is difficult to watch. It is.
Yeah. Where can people get tickets? Where should they be to come and see you?
Okay, it's on at the Plowright Theatre at Scunthorpe. And I'm going to use this because I've gone to the box office number is 0844 854 2776. And there's also, they have a website at www.plowrighttheatre.com.
And the dates of the run?
It's 7th to the 11th of March. At 7:30
have
in the evening.
Have excellent production. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Here's Dan with all the sports news.
Harry Maguire's impressive form this season has come as no surprise to his teammates. That's according to his fellow centre-half Curtis Davis at Hull City. Maguire's performances have been praised in the media in recent weeks by pundits and opponents. And Davis says that the defender, still aged only 23, has become one of the leaders in the Tigers' squad. Maguire and the rest of Marco Silva's team are due to head home from their week-long training camp in Portugal shortly, ahead of Saturday's home clash with Burnley. North Ferriby United manager Steve Howsham says his squad have improved and got to grips better with the National League over the course of the season. The Villagers lost 1-0 at home to leaders and FA Cup quarter-finalists Lincoln City last night, but lost 6-1 at Sinsel Bank in the reverse fixture back in August. And the Ferriby boss is taking heart from their narrow defeat yesterday.
They're a different class to us, don't get me wrong, Lincoln, and they're a bit stronger than us, but you'd expect that because of full-time. You know, it's like I talk to my players, we do change formations, you know, to give it a go, ask questions of Lincoln. I thought we did today, and, you know, like you say, we've grown into bigger men than what we was that night, because we got bullied and punished a lot that night. So, you know, we've really, really improved from that day.
On to rugby now, and Hull FC's Danny Washbrook could be in line to make his 150th Super League appearance for the club tomorrow night. The standoff has been at the Black and White since 2005, barring a three-year stay at Wakefield Trinity. And his current head coach, Lee Radford, says he leads by example around the team's younger players. FC host Catalans Dragons at the KCOM Stadium tomorrow night in their first home game of the 2017 season. And finally, Yorkshire cricketer Ryan Sidebottom has announced his retirement today. The left-arm bowler played 22 test matches for England, as well as playing in 25 one-day internationals. He was also part of the Yorkshire back-to-back county championship wins in 2014 and 15. He'll represent the county for the 2017 season before hanging up his whites. And that's all for the sport.
Thanks very much, Dan, and thanks very much to my guest tonight, Re Tattoos or 9to5. If you have a story for us, then please visit our Facebook or Twitter pages. Email news@estuary.tv or phone 01472 31553 as displayed below. Write to us at Estuary TV, Nuns Corner, Grimsby, DN345BQ. We'd love to hear from you. Until tomorrow, good evening.
Are you looking for a new or used car? Whatever the weather, Trenton have you covered. Estuary TV Weather, sponsored by Trenton Motors.
Hello there and welcome to Estuary TV's weather. Thursday cloudy with periods of heavy rain at first, wintry over the hills, then turning colder with wintry showers, severe gales causing significant disruption where winds are strongest in the south, maximum temperatures of 7 degrees. Friday, it's going to be cold and sunny intervals with the odd shower. More rain later. Are you looking for a new or used car? Whatever the weather, Trenton have you covered. Estuary TV Weather, sponsored by Trenton Motors.
Good evening, you're watching Estuary News, I'm Hugh Richards. In the headlines tonight, a motorcyclist dies in Bottisford, a man is assaulted in Grimsby, the future of the Humberston Fitties, and iconic Hull figures adorning the city's streets. And later in tonight's programme, Luke will be here to tell me his roundup of the City of Culture news. A motorcyclist has died following a collision in North Lincolnshire yesterday. The 37-year-old was riding a green Kawasaki motorcycle when it left the carriageway on Holmes Lane in Bottisford shortly before 5:30 p.m. The driver was pronounced dead at the scene. Three men have been arrested on suspicion of assault in Cleethorpes. The incident happened at 6 o'clock yesterday evening in Brereton Avenue, when a 21-year-old man was assaulted. The three suspects were arrested on suspicion of causing grievous bodily harm and remain in custody. The victim was taken to Hull Royal Infirmary with head injuries. Hull's Ferrens Art Gallery has seen a massive visitors since it reopened last month. More than 92,000 people have visited the gallery following a 16-month refurbishment programme that cost £5.1 million. One of the masterpieces on display is a rare piece of 14th century work by Pietro Lorenzetti. The gallery's curator, Kirsten Simister, says the hard work has paid off.
Well, the gallery opened on the 13th of January and the visitor figures have been really fantastic. So we've had over 92,000 people through the doors in just over the first month of opening, which is quite scary actually when you come down and just see the sheer volume of people that are in. But it's also absolutely wonderful to see the exhibits being enjoyed as they are at the moment, and obviously that's what we've worked incredibly hard
to try and do to deliver a really exciting and ambitious programme for the year.
A 56-year-old man has been assaulted in Grimsby. The incident happened shortly before 3 a.m. this morning outside a takeaway on Victoria Street when he was approached by three men and assaulted. The victim was taken to Grimsby Hospital for treatment for a cut to the back of his head. Hull North MP Diana Johnson has today attacked the unfair distribution of transport investment between London and parts of the North. Latest figures released by the Treasury show that in 2016-17, infrastructure investment is nearly £2,000 per head in London, but only £190 per head in Yorkshire and the Humber. Speaking in the House of Commons today, Ms Johnson questioned whether the Northern Powerhouse has any benefits for Hull, as she feels the city isn't getting a good deal. David Lidington MP, leader of the House, said the government is investing £13 billion in transport improvements across the north. The people of the Humberston Fitties won't have their homes taken away from them. That's the message they're currently sending out. Appealing to holidaygoers for decades, many of these seaside houses have recently become proper homes. The header lease for the area is now up for sale, and the Fitties community is fighting to keep their homes secure. Fred McNamara spoke to some Fitties owners to find out more.
The Humberston Fitties have been appealing to holidaymakers and homeowners for decades, but their future is now uncertain, resulting in the Fitties community banding together to preserve their beloved homes.
The Fitties is something that's been here and people have enjoyed since the early 1900s, actually. What the history is that people used to come down to the area just to enjoy the wonderful beach, the coast, and this particular area that we're sat on here. They used to bring down tents and just set about cooking on the dunes and enjoying, let the kids run free. Just have a great time. So it's got a massive history to it in terms of holiday makers, but actually it's also got an even sort of a more noble purpose when in the World War One, soldiers that were based out at Hale Sands Fort were actually based here. They used it as a base for the soldiers, so it's got that history and background as well. So what's happening at the moment is that we have about 320 chalets on site and chalet owners, and very much still a community spirit here. And what's happened is we were made aware of the fact that the council were selling the header lease, so we have really come together as a community. Very exciting times for us to actually put our own bid together for that. We do really believe that nobody kind of understands this area, this site. Nobody loves this site and really understands its heritage and is as proud of its heritage as we are. So we've actually pledged our own money to get us to the situation where we can actually go forward with the proposal to the council, which we've put in, and we've formed a community interest company, as you mentioned, and that the exciting thing about that is that it's a not-for-profit organisation. So that means that if we are successful in winning the bid for the lease, all of the money that our company would actually gain from ground rents, etc., would actually be reinvested back into the community, back into the site and into its infrastructure.
In the press recently, they've stated that if anybody else buys it other than us, that we will be walking away with our suitcases. And we've all invested. I mean, if you take a low average of £60,000 a property, that equates at 320 properties to £20 million. So there's £20 million of equity plus on this site that we've all bought, and they're not towable. We can't move them away. They're our homes.
The community, this sort of village atmosphere, makes the Fitties what it is. It's the people, actually, that make the Fitties, as well as nature. And we are nature's guardians here. We take that very seriously. And any little chalet that you visit, you will see that people, or the gardens are different, but people care about their environment, and that's important because it's an SSSI site. We've got a big RSPB reserve, and they're very interested in how things are going to move on or not. And we take this role very seriously.
With future plans to bring renewed public interest to the Fitties, this secluded corner of the Humber is keen to remain in the hands of its community. For McNamara, Estuary News.
And the council's joint scrutiny panels met last night. In a statement issued to Estuary News, a North East Lincolnshire Council spokesperson said The joint panels were reassured by the evaluation of the preferred bidder and safeguards provided by the portfolio holder for finance, resources and inclusion that ward councillors would be involved in agreeing the detailed terms of the disposal. On that basis, they continue, it was agreed to recommend to Cabinet that the offer from the preferred bidder be approved. We asked, but the council declined to reveal the identity of the preferred bidder. Humberside Police has today launched an appeal to university employees and students. This is after reports of fraudsters sending phishing emails to steal their personal details. The emails appear to be from the university's HR department, claiming the recipient is entitled to a pay rise and to click on a link. It then takes the victim to a fake university website which asks for financial details. The information is then used by the criminals to steal from their victims. Detective Sergeant Ivan Sims from the force said he hopes the warning may prevent others falling for the scam. One of Hull's most well-known companies is now part of the City of Culture story. KCOM has launched a new scheme to honour 95 of the city's most prominent names to be adorned on their fleet of vans. The ex-Deputy Prime Minister, Lord Prescott, John Prescott, has been revealed as the first name, but the company is calling on the public to nominate more Hullensians to brand the remaining vehicles.
We've had well over 100 so far, and some that you might expect. We've had some historical figures. We've had William Wilberforce and Amy Johnson. Also some sporting people, Nick Bambi, Dean Windass, and a few perhaps a bit more unusual ones. Vanny McVanface might not make the final cut, and lots actually for the Bee Lady Jean Bishop, probably not surprisingly. We've started with number one, Lord Prescott, obviously one of Hull's most famous political figures, and what we're hoping is that the public will give us suggestions for the names of the other 94 vans.
A survey has been launched into children's and young people's mental health services in Hull. Health Watch is asking parents, carers and professionals how they feel about the CAMHS service. The Care Quality Commission found there were concerns over waiting lists and issues around procedures for reporting incidents when it conducted a review in 2014. The survey is available online via the Health Watch website until the end of March. It asks 18 questions on how the CAMHS service could be improved. East Riding Council has launched a drive to encourage more residents to put their food waste in brown wheelie bins. Officers will put orange tags on green bins to remind residents not to put food waste in those in a bid to recycle a further 4,000 tonnes of waste every year. The council says food waste makes up nearly a third of all waste put in green bins in the East Riding. The initiative will launch in March across 8 areas, including Beverley, Hesel and Kirkella, and it'll be rolled out across the whole county later in the year. Modern-day Hull and its 1940s incarnation will collide in a production by the Hesel Road Network. 1940s to now will chart the past 70 years in the area, including the decline of the fishing industry and how living has changed. Young people from the network will be putting on a production to help them gain an understanding of the past as part of Hull 2017 tomorrow evening. Gemma Barker explains how significant the event will be.
The whole experience of being part of City of Culture is going to be quite an historical event for them, really, being part of something so amazing and big for our city. And it's just going to be a big confidence boost for the young people. It may inspire them for the future, whether they want to go into performing in any sort of aspect of dance or drama, or just the fact of achieving that one performance of the evening and making everybody proud.
And join me after the break. Fred will be bringing us a roundup of all the latest sports news, and I'll be joined by our very own Luke to tell me all about this week's events in the City of Culture. Welcome back. You're watching Estuary News. Still to come tonight, Fred will be bringing us a roundup of the latest sports news, and Luke joins me on the sofa with his weekly digest of Hull 2017 happenings. The farmers of northeast Lincolnshire are being educated in the ways of information technology. The Technology for Information Literacy Project, or TIL for short, comes from the Prince's Countryside Trust. It aims to develop the IT skills of farmers to meet the demands of the dynamic agricultural industry. Fred McNamara spoke to some farmers at the Louth Learning Centre to find out more.
Farmers from across northeast Lincolnshire are brushing up on their IT skills. The Technology Information Project, put together by the Prince's Countryside Trust, aims to encourage farmers to improve their IT skills in order to meet the modern demands of the agricultural industry.
Well, how we found out was at the local market. People were advertising that this was available, and it was felt on behalf of the business, so to speak, I ought to come and hone my skills somewhat.
I just felt that at my age it's a good idea to get up to date with the latest technology of what's going on. And computers, if you're not careful, you get left behind. So the more information you can get, I think the better. Well, I mean, obviously searching information, I use a lot of spreadsheets, Word documents, and so just everyday use that any farmer would use in the business, I guess.
We are all rooted in when the computers first came out, and technology has advanced so much. Like me, Excel sort of scares the daylights out of me. But being here and learning about it makes it so much more friendly than I ever thought it was.
It's always good to find shortcuts on any programs you're using, and it's quite handy to get a general introduction. You always learn something new. So it's not necessarily any one particular thing, but generally you get a better feel for what you're doing.
I've decided that I do need a lot more polishing, so I shall be back.
Yeah, I think definitely I shall keep trying to improve. There's always room for improvement. Every day's a learning day.
The rise in technology's role in farming means that farmers are becoming eager to match their own skills with the skills of their livelihoods. From McNamara, Estuary News.
And I'm joined now by our very own Luke Adams, who is synonymous with sartorial style, to talk about the City of Culture. Luke,
all
welcome.
In the name of City of Culture, Hugh, as you say. Lovely to be here as always. Thursday comes around so quick, doesn't it?
It does. Well, that's a good sign.
Breaking news to kick off with. The Pigeon Detectives, who are a group of Yorkshire indie rockers, were scheduled to be coming to the city tonight and tomorrow to perform a gig at various locations. And they've had to cancel the gig because one of their lead singers has fallen ill.
That's not good.
No, it hasn't. It is not good news. And he's issued a quote. This is Matt Berman from the group, who says, "Unfortunately, due to some complications from what I thought was a simple procedure on my knees, we've had to cancel tonight and tomorrow's shows in Hull. Currently, I'm unable to stand due to swelling in my knee, and I can't possibly provide the live show that our fans deserve. I'm treating my knee the best I can to reduce swelling and aim to make Saturday's show." So they're hoping that Saturday show will go ahead. People who've bought tickets for tonight and tomorrow's show will be fully reimbursed over the next 7 days.
Excellent. Well, let's hope he recovers extremely quickly.
Fingers crossed. Now, Ferrans have a new exhibition, which we reported yesterday, called Skins. This is in conjunction with the fantastic Sea of Hull event, which took place in July last summer around the Humber Bridge area.
Who could forget it, yes.
200 people. Brave the cold and were completely naked, all just in blue.
And painted in blue paint,
yeah. That's right, yeah, which I think we covered it, didn't we?
Extensively.
And we was there yesterday to have a look at the launch of this exhibition, and we caught up with a couple of those who've taken part and whose photographs will be there. I think we've got a little VT coming up.
Okay, let's have a look.
Being able to come is absolutely amazing. It just brings it all back again, all the camaraderie, the atmosphere, just how lucky we are really to be the City of Culture and be able to do things like this.
I want to be part of Hull. I want to celebrate the city that we are, and you know, this is an amazing experience for me. So yeah, when I heard about it, I looked at his pictures online, I thought, you can't not be. It's just a chance in a lifetime.
It's a strange sight, isn't it?
It is. And such a vision of blue as well.
It's wonderful.
And you saw from there, Hugh, that there was obviously very proud to take part, and obviously now that they've got their work on show at the gallery.
And I think there's also Manet and Lucian Freud.
Yes, that's right. There's all sorts going on. I think it's become one of the Hull City Centre's cultural hubs, and it's only been open just over a month, as we saw in the headline story.
Ferens is having a very good year of culture so far, isn't it?
Our very good friend to Estuary TV, Audrey Dunn, has announced that she's taking part in the City of Culture.
Excellent.
With her work of poetry. Through on the Saturday the 11th of March at the Kingston Art Gallery, 2 o'clock until 4 o'clock. It's part of the Women of the World event, and she's going to be delivering a series of poems at the gallery.
Will that be her own poems?
Yes, it is. Yes, looking at the Lonsborough, Yorkshire, Wolds area.
And I thought I saw a note about some musical accompaniment there as
well. Yeah, that's right, from a musician called Claire Holdate. She will be adding further dimensions to the poems with the sounds of the flute.
Splendid. Okay.
Okay, and this week, Hugh, is the last chance for people to catch the Lines of Thought exhibition at the University of Hull. And that's obviously showcasing some of the work of Rembrandt, Michelangelo, Matisse.
And the great point is it's drawings.
That's right, drawings.
The skill of draftsmanship
drawings.
Is what they're concentrating
that's
on.
That's right. Free exhibition, and that's in the Bryn Mawr Jones Library at the University, and that's running until Tuesday.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
And tomorrow night at the Cardome 94, there's an All Sorts Variety Night featuring an array of artistry, including a violinist Chris Herron. Graham Bett will be performing tracks from his latest album, and Humber Film will be screening their soundtrack of the Made in Hull event, and that kicks off at 8 o'clock, tickets roughly £10.
Very quickly, one more.
Well, we've covered Brandzone quite a lot, but just quickly to say that Brandzone 50 Years in Pictures, a new exhibition, a pop-up exhibition at the North Point Shopping Centre, showcasing their first 50 years in photographs, and there's also a 12-page newspaper article.
Luke, brilliant, thank you very much.
See you next week.
Okay, here's Fred with all the sports news.
Hull FC will be playing their first home game at the KCOM Stadium tonight against the Catalan Dragons in front of a record crowd. The Black and Whites won their first game of the new campaign against Warrington Wolves in the south of France, and head coach Lee Radford believes there was a definite buzz around the opposition team compared to last season. Tonight's game is set to be Hull FC's highest ever attendance for a Catalan's home game this evening, surpassing the 2007 record. 13,000 fans are expected to turn out at a jam-packed KCOM Stadium tonight. North Ferriby United manager Steve Howsham says he's proud of his side in their battle against relegation from the National League. It's the Villagers' first experience in the top tier of non-league football, something which looks like ending the relegation come the end of the season. They're 7 points adrift of safety, but the United boss says he's impressed with just how close his team have got to winning points against some tough opponents in many of their games this season.
It's hard, and it's hard to come in week in, week out, and you know, that's two games on the bounce now. I think it tallies up to about 15 games where we've lost by the one goal. But we're competing well, but we all know to get out of this you need the 3 points, and you know, I can't fault any of my players. I'm proud of them all. They fight for their lives, and they just keep on going.
Bolton referee Darren Hanley will be the man in the middle as the Mariners travel to Morecambe on Saturday. He was promoted to the EFL in the 2014-15 season after spending 6 years in the National League. He's taken charge of the Mariners on two occasions so far this season, those being the 5-2 victory over Stevenage in August and the 2-0 success over Notts County in January. Handley will be assisted by Christopher Ward, Danny Grafton and fourth official Paul Hodkinson. Hull KR's club historian Dave Sherwood has announced he is to step down from his role. He's held the position for the last 19 years and says it's been a great honour and pleasure to fulfil the role over the years. He will be replaced by notable club historian Roger Pugh, who has followed the club since 1968. Sherwood has a long history with the KR, having watched them play back in 1955, and in 1979 he embarked on a run of 935 consecutive Rovers games. He's recently stepped down from his roles as chairman of Beverley ARLC and the Hull and District Historical Research Group, and said that now is the right time to cut down on his commitments. And Cleethorpes Town is set to welcome Pickering Town in the away team's biggest game of the season this Saturday. Clee will take their players into the game full of confidence and self-belief as they go into their second league fixture. New players have arrived to bolster the squad since the new year. The Owls are hoping a win will restore some breathing space between the two teams, with two league games at home in 4 days. Kickoff is at 3 p.m. and that's all for the sport.
Thanks very much, Fred. That's pretty much all we have for you tonight. If you want to get in touch, the details are below me, news@estuary.tv, or give us a call on 01472 31553. Until tomorrow, good evening.
Are you looking for a new or used car? Whatever the weather, Trenton have you covered. Estuary TV Weather, sponsored by Trenton Motors.
Hello and welcome to Estuary TV's weather. On Friday, we're in for a cold one with thick clouds coming in from the west. Meanwhile, cold showers also remain across the region. Some sunny spells will be present. Meanwhile, the weekend remains more or less the same with spotty showers and gusts of wind.
Are you looking for a new or used car? Whatever the weather, Trenton have you covered. Estuary TV Weather, sponsored by Trenton Motors.